Thank you for being here. We're glad that you were here. If this is your first time, it is a privilege to have you as our guest. There are some communication cards and a few in front of you. I would love for you to take it out, fill it out. When the offering bag comes by in a little bit, drop it in the offering bag, and next week through the mail. We're not going to irritate you or annoy you, but through the mail. Hopefully send you information that will answer a lot of questions you have about New Hope, what we believe, the ministries we're engaged in, the times of all of our various services. So we'd love for you to take the opportunity to do that. This morning, early, I had an epiphany moment. I'd
walked over to the bridge early to the office, and the sun was just coming up in the east, just starting to come up, clear, crisp morning. And when I looked to my left, the moon, the full moon, was just full right there, about ready to set, full sun right here. And I'm just staring right and left, and I'm thinking, whoa, how could I get a picture of this? And there was no way I could figure that out. But it was just absolutely incredible. And then on top of that, God sent some music. As I'm standing there doing this, a flock of geese get up out of this ponding basin over here and come right over, all right, and just honking. I'm thinking, wow, God, you've given me worship already this morning. And I think, wow, and there really are people who believe all of that just happened as an accident. Over millions of years, we have this sun that perfectly does its thing, and this moon rotating, and the setting of a moon, rising of a sun, and the seasons that comes based on how all that stuff works. That takes a lot of faith to believe that just happened by accident. And I thought, wow, thank you, Lord. And just hold on to that image if you can. It ties into where we are in Psalm chapter 8 today. I love when God does that kind of things in the morning. But welcome. If you are visiting New Hope Church, there's a communication card in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill one out, drop it in the offering bag. We do our best not to annoy you, aggravate you, but send you some information through the mail. We hope we'll answer questions about what we believe and who we are and what times our services and activities are around here. So we'd love to get that information from you. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests, and we'll get engaged in our worship today. Let's see here. I don't think they're in here. They're coming next service. Okay. This coming Friday afternoon, Steve and Lee Childress and Lindsay Eccles and myself will be in San Francisco, spending the night there to get on a plane early next Saturday morning to head to Chicago, Brussels, Ivory Coast, Africa, sleep for about 5 hours, take an 18-hour bus ride to Doropo, Ivory Coast, Africa, and get there to those people you've heard so much over the last few years, and to meet some brand new folks, to share with them the miracle of medicine, to share with them the miracle of education, and to share with them, most of all, the miracle of the love of Jesus Christ. And Steve Childress has got a special project he was just given a month ago, and that was to take, since he's an IT guru, all right, to take some software and some computer hardware that they can inventory all the medical supplies that they have there. So when a doctor in one of the four surgery rooms says, I need this, we don't have to run to three different storage rooms and find out where it is. We'll know exactly where to find it. And when they put out requests for medical supplies, we won't be getting things that we already have in good supply. We'll get the stuff that we need. And so, as you can see, missionary work involved being able to or preach a sermon, or teach a class. There's other ways that the 21st century can have an impact on in another part of the world. So continue to pray for that trip. Thank you so much. Yesterday, the Women's Fervent Bible Study on Prayer got kicked off. Some were not able to attend because they were attending another conference in town. You're welcome to join them next Saturday. It's a one-hour Bible study from 9 to 10, and I understand there were about 30 women present. So awesome. On way to go. Now that is praying, okay? Yeah, praying together. All right. next Sunday, you're going to hear during Life in the Church, you're going to hear from our youth pastor, Chris, about the upcoming Mexico mission launch, all right? And so just getting us ready for that. Next Sunday evening at 5 o'clock. 8 o'clock, there is going to be a citywide celebration, the Twin Cities, Fresno and Clovis, celebration at Fresno Pacific University, breaking the 21-day prayer and fasting. 120 folks from New Hope have been engaged in praying and fasting, doing something different than normal. It's not always fasting from food, but other things, putting us more in a position to pray for revival in our cities and renewals in our churches. And so I've been getting some feedback from folks who were doing it, and man, it's all been good. All been good. I've noticed a few of you have lost a little weight too. Wonderful. Just a bonus, all right, in the process. But you all are welcome to go there. I'm going to do his best to be there, so we'll have representation from New Hope, but would love to have several of you go and share in service at Fresno Pacific University. Grief share, and that's the only sign-up sheet I have coming around. If you have experienced a death and loss in your life over the last year, so even if it's been longer than that, you've been challenged by that, grief share is a wonderful place to find encouragement, comfort, and help, all right, for the future. Hundreds of people have been through that since we've been doing grief share here at New Hope. There's going to be 2 times to work on your schedule, so please indicate which time, place for your name, your phone number, your email contact, and indicate which day. Tuesday mornings, 9:30 to 11:30, or Wednesday evenings, 6:30 to 8:30. So information is on there, and we would love your information if you want to be a part of that. Let's see here. Ladies, please take note of the date of a very special luncheon coming up. Tickets are going to go on sale in 2 weeks, all right, for that very special women's luncheon. How many of you this past week received an envelope from the church and it was your statement for 2015? Raise your hand. That makes me feel really good. Okay, a lot of hands went up. If you didn't yet, don't sweat it. They went out kind of on separate days, I believe, over the last part of the week last week. If you do not have yours by Wednesday, please call the church office, okay? And they will fix what is wrong with that. And what's wrong with that could be your fault, could be our fault, but we'll fix whichever one it is. If you have moved, changed addresses, and didn't tell us, then we it's gone to your old address. We may have typed something wrong, and so send it to a wrong address if you don't receive it. The third option is, and this has happened on a few times, well, I know I gave, how did you, well, I put cash. If you don't put that cash in an envelope and put your name on it, body for it, all right? So we want to give you credit, but we don't fingerprint the bills, all right, to figure out who it is. So please let us know if you don't get yours. Some, just as a reminder, if in the future, because some people go for their taxes really early, you don't have to wait to get one from the mail of us. You can go online and download your own and print it yourself. If you don't know how to do that, call the office. They'll walk you. It's a pretty simple procedure, but there's a way you can do that all on your own as well. All right? Mark and I, Mark, where are you? Are you in here? I saw you. Mark, stand up. Mark, stand up. Let me just, Mark, a member of our pastoral staff, as you know. Right? And Mark and I have scheduled a very special event coming up February the 21st. If we have missed you, we want to get a personal invitation in your hand. And sometimes I've had to ask a few people, are you over? Every one of you, except that would be a lie, and I shouldn't do that. Some of you I can tell, Jerry Brown. But on the evening of the 21st, we have an invitation. It's very personal and important to both Mark and I that as many of you, whether you are single or married, children, no children, divorced, widowed, but you find yourself in that area 15 to 40, we want to meet you there. We want to talk with, 25. Did I say 50? Yeah. 25 to 40. Yeah. I have very many married with children, 15-year-olds, all right? So, yeah, 25 to 40. 25. Sometimes the mouth runs faster than the brain. Don't know if any of you have ever had that issue, but I have. So we would love to have you that night. It's only going to be about 45 minutes, hour at the absolute most. We've got some really nice refreshments for you, and child care is going to be available that evening. All right, for that time you're here. I suspect this may be one of the most significant meetings in the last this last decade of my ministry here at New Hope, okay? I'm pretty confident that this will be one of those very, very significant times in the life of our church. So hope you will come and be with us, all right? Men, I hope you noticed that there's a special one-day seminar coming to town on men's ministries. And you can see Mark about tickets for that, but would love to have you, and that is in the month of March. You'll hear more from us later about that. A few prayer requests. This happened about 2 weeks ago. I did not mention it last Sunday, but Owen Glazebrook, all right, the Blankenship's little grandson, he's about 6 years old. He shattered his leg, all right? He had to have surgery, had to have a rod put in it. Man, a six-year-old in a wheelchair is just no fun for anybody. It's not fun for him. It's not fun for his parents. Not fun for the grandparents who are looking after him during the daytime. So just be praying for his recovery. They would appreciate that so much. Yesterday, 11 o'clock at Bethany Church in Fresno was the memorial celebration for Pastor Robert Radke. I knew Robert from the 1970s, all right, when he was pastor at Bethany. I knew him when he started the original New Hope Church, Brook Church, and he and his wife Ione moved back here a few years ago. They had served in Saskatchewan, pastoring up there. He'd served with the Billy Graham Association as well, and he passed away just before last weekend. So would appreciate you remembering Ione and his family. Some of you know his son. His son's a chiropractor here in Clovis for a long, long time. And just be praying for the family. It was a great celebration. Bob loved the Lord with all of his heart. He and Ione had been visiting in their living room. She got up and went to see the neighbors for about 10 minutes and came back, and he had moved. He had moved to heaven. And so very peaceful, very quick, and certainly a very God-honoring service yesterday. Be praying for Anna Correa and her family. I met Anna a couple years ago at a wedding I had the privilege of officiating. Mike Chin's associate that works with him, and Anna happens to be her neighbor, and Anna's 94-year-old mom, born in Germany, died in the same town she was born in Germany, but she, for 6 to 13 weeks every year, would come over and hang out in Clovis, where her relatives were, and her daughter brought her over a year and a half or 2 years ago to stay here, and she only stayed about 4 months and said, no, I need to go back home, but when I die, I want to die in Germany. But when you bury me, I want to be buried in Clovis. So Tuesday, we are on. And I just want you to be praying for their family. Pray for me, because I think there's about 8 different German names I've got to figure out how to say, okay, between now and Tuesday. And so some of them are kind of easy. Some of them are not quite so easy. All right, so we're going to work on those. But be praying for them. They would appreciate that so much. It's great to see Hazel and Phil out with us today. I want to thank all of you for your calls, your cards, helping with the desserts for the memorial service. Their son, Dwayne, was, I tell you what, I have a sneaking suspicion that there were eternal life decisions made that day at his service. Dwayne, as he brought life back to young children in the work that he did physically, I am pretty confident in the message and the life example of his life. There were eternal decisions made at his service this past week. So he was still doing good work. So continue to pray for Phil and Hazel and God's best comfort in their lives in the weeks ahead. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Is everybody warm? I see some people fanning. Anybody cold? Okay, we can probably turn the heaters off then, if you would, please. Let's turn them off. Thank you. Would you? Oh, man, be a good offer. Taking the offering today. All right. You can't mess it up. The only wrong thing is if you reach in a lot. That's the only bad thing. Let's pray. Father, sense of humor, you created me, but thank you that you afford to us the opportunity, even in worship, to laugh. We can cry, we can laugh, we can become contemplative, we can be exceedingly serious. And God, all of those are expressions that you find honoring. And so, Father, we trust you with our needs today. I have no idea how everyone showed up here today, but I'm confident most of us have needs. Some of those needs are public and others know, and some of them are very private and personal. And Father, I trust that not my words, but your Spirit will speak directly to each of us about how we should handle those needs in our life at this moment. You brought us here for a purpose. Even if some came unwillingly, they're here for a purpose. And it's your purpose, not mine, not New Hope's, but it's yours. And I trust that we'll be attentive to allowing you to accomplish that purpose in our life. Father, for the needs of care and comfort, for Phil and Hazel, for Ann and her family, for others, Lord, we continue to trust you for your best in their lives. For those who've had surgery this past week and are recovering, and those with surgeries and treatments still pending for the coming week, we commit those to you. Lord, for the trip to the Ivory Coast coming up very, very soon, we pray for your leadership, your strength, your power, your influence to be evident in all that is said and done and worked for. Father, we trust that your Son, the Lord Jesus, will be honored in all that is said and done, in the way in which we choose to live our lives this day. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. I invite you to take your Bible and find Bible's hymnal number 8. I emailed one of my mentors during my Bible college days, one of my very, very good friends still, and some of you have met him. It's Jack Williams. Jack has preached before. He was here for my mom's memorial service, lives in Nashville. And I emailed him earlier this week and kind of gave him the background of this year's sermon series. And I said, Jack, if you've got any just incredible insights on the Psalms, send them to me. I am an open vessel looking for what God may want to use with our church family. And I heard back from him, and one of the first things that he said was, Tim, just remember, there's no chapters in the book of Psalms. You think about your hymnal, and there's no chapters in a hymnal. There's page numbers where the songs are. So, from now on, if I say turn to chapter so-and-so in the book of Psalms, you all have permission. Tim, there are no chapters in Psalms, okay? All right? So, I'm asking you to turn to the song that's number 8 in the hymnal that we find in the Bible. It's your first Sunday here, just a brief catch-up. The first Sunday of this year, our theme for 2016 around New Hope is the less, more lifestyle. And we looked at a series of things most of us would like to have less of by the time we get to the end of this year, things we would like to have more of. And we looked at it from a purely personal perspective. We looked at it from a contextual perspective. We looked at it then, most important of all, and it's what this series is all about, from a biblically personal perspective. And it's John the Baptist who summarized it best when he had been on the forefront. He had been the most popular person. Everybody knew John the Baptist. They would come to hear him preach in the wilderness. Jesus showed up on the scene. John the Baptist said, I must decrease. There must be less of me, and Christ must increase. The world must see more of him. The Apostle Paul advanced that whole thought process a little more in his writings when he said, I am crucified with Christ, so that it's not I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. So the life that I live today, right now, at this moment, it is not me, but it's Christ who is alive and seen in me. Less of me, more of Christ. Think about the moment in your life, if you've had this moment. Most of you have, but maybe not everybody yet. Think about the moment you became a Christian. Okay? Not the moment you became a Baptist or a Catholic or a Presbyterian. The moment you became a Christian. Not the moment of your birth. You were born, if you were born here, you were born an American. If you were born in Mexico, you were born a citizen of Mexico. If you were born in Germany, whether you are of German descent or German citizen, none of that will make you a Christian. Your location of birth doesn't make you a Christian. It is the location of your second birth. Realizing someday death will take this physical life, and what is there going to be on the other side? And so you realize that you want to have eternal life. And this God of the universe doesn't just come to give us life in heaven when we die, but He comes to bring His life while we live. And so think about the moment that happened for you. At that moment, it's when you and I should already start to begin the process of what John the Baptist said, I must decrease and Jesus Christ must increase. And every day and every year that we continue to live and we grow and we mature in our faith walk with Jesus Christ, there ought to be less of me and more of Him. That's the reason for the study in the Psalms. We believe that in order for that to be true, in order for this less, more lifestyle to become reality for all of us, it can only happen if there's four things in play in our life. And it starts with what? We must choose Christ to be the Lord of our life, to be the Redeemer from our sin. It starts with a choice. This choice made once and for all. Okay? This so incredible choice that we make, it doesn't end there. That's just the starting point. In order for that choice that we made in our life, to invite Christ into us, in order for the lifestyle of less and more to be reality, it must be maintained by what? Consistency. Perfect. That choice that was made once must be made, really, every single day. That's why Paul, again, said, I die daily, every day. There must be this willingness that, hey, I want less of me and more of Him in all that I do today. So, starts with a choice. It's maintained with consistency. That consistency is really only possible when we have accountability. Okay? Accountability with God, but let's be honest, sometimes we can kind of ignore Him if we want to, but we need to put some folks in our life that are going to hold us accountable to these choices that we're making consistently, and who are probably the best people to be your accountability partners in this growing life of Christ? Small group is one of the answers, but it's not the first answer. That's a good one, though. Thank you. Okay, if you're married, it's going to be your spouse. Because who knows? See, you could show up at church on a Sunday, and you can con all of us. Con all of you one day a week. I can't con her 7 days a week. Okay? She sees what I'm like when I wake up in the morning. She sees what I'm like when I go to bed at night. And she pretty well sees everything in between. Okay? We can't con the people that we live with. So whether it's a spouse, whether it's a roommate, whether it's a son or a daughter at appropriate age, okay? A best friend. Certainly a small group would be a great place. But hold me. I want there to be this less more. And these are the areas you know I struggle in. Hold me accountable, will you? And then the fourth part of that process, which is foreign to the vast majority of us, is what? Contemplation. Slow, steady process of thinking and dwelling upon the Word of God and how it impacts and has implications in my daily life. We are so accustomed to stop and goes and Johnny Quicks that the slow, steady contemplation of God's Word is pretty foreign to us. We want sound bites. We want 20-minute sermons, unless you come to New Hope. Okay? Anybody else? Okay, maybe we need the one on the left side, put it on like 72. Okay, your other left. Yeah, that one will work. Okay, good. Yeah, well, see, my left and his left facing each other are different. So, okay, so that brings us to where we're going to be today in Psalm chapter 8. All of us, I often don't say all unless I can be pretty sure it's an accurate statement, but all of us like to be needed. Any disagreements? We like to be wanted. We like to be needed. Great men and women have longed to leave their mark on the world. And for many who may not even be world famous, there's this desire to leave a legacy that will continue after we have passed away. In our younger years, we tend to derive our self-worth from our ability to contribute to others and to assist others in their need. And I wished I could say all of us were altruistic in doing that. I wished I... That was a pretty big word for me, huh? Yeah. Google that one if you want to, all right, if you haven't heard that one in a while. I wished I could say all of us did it for noble reasons. I reflected back when I was in my mid to late teens, all of my older friends in church, okay, those in my sister's age group, all of them were getting married, all very quickly, boom, boom, just like dominoes, they were falling. And I did not intend that in the way in which you all took it, all right? But it was just happening, and I mean, these were all people I grew up with and were friends, and I was, you know, most of them I was involved in the wedding in some form or fashion. I was a little too old for a ring bearer, but I was an usher or a groomsman or, anyway, volunteer help because these were good friends. And I remember after a while I said, man, I've cleaned up after a bucket load of receptions. This was in the days in which they weren't big banquet halls, all right? You set it all up yourself. You cleaned it up yourself. And I look back this past week and I said, why did I do all that? And I wished I could tell you it was because I really loved them. And I did. I mean, I just didn't sign up to do that for strangers. But I look back, there was something about this 15, 16, 17-year-old kid who would work long after almost everybody else was gone except for the parents of the bride and the groom who were still cleaning up. And I say, you know what, if I look back and I'm really honest with myself, I did it because I had this need to be approved, to be appreciated, to be complimented, to hear somebody say, wow, he's not lazy. He knows how to work. I wonder how many things we do in life we do for those reasons. That's what Psalm 8 has been written for us for. You see, there comes a day that energy levels are not as high. I haven't volunteered to stay after in quite a while and clean up at a wedding reception. I used to help in my 20s. I helped a lot of people a lot of times move. Some people love to move. I hate it. Okay? I really don't like it. I don't rush out and volunteer to help people move a whole lot anymore. And why? Yeah. You see, ever so slowly and sometimes even abruptly without warning, we find ourselves sidelined and no longer in demand. One circumstance or another can seize our usefulness and leave us reeling in its devastating wake. You know, injustice can take our freedom. By the way, justice can also take our freedom. Right? Slander can destroy our reputation. Illness can sap our strength. Bad fortune can remove our financial security. Depression leaves us without hope. And let's not forget, the steady intrusion of age takes away our vitality. Merely growing older can move us out of the fast lane into the slow lane, except on Highway 99, where people choose to drive slow in the fast lane. I'm just saying. It's one of those areas I need to be held accountable on at those moments. By being passed over for a job or a promotion or being benched on a team because a stronger player joins us, if we're not careful, we'll get the feeling of being overlooked and underappreciated. And that hurts. Here's the interesting dichotomy in our theme and reality. The theme is the less, more lifestyle. But none of us like the feeling of less. The eighth song in God's ancient hymnal is a great one for these times in our lives when we feel bypassed or set aside. It highlights the value that God places upon His creatures, and no one is more valuable to Him than humanity, you and me. I'm going to stop periodically through this and just give you a few questions to ponder about what we've just chatted about. So just little things that if you want to write down, you can, or ignore. It's okay too. But a few thoughts so far where we are. How do you measure your own worth and your own value as a person? When you look back over your life, what is it that you use to guesstimate how valuable you are? How many churches you've pastored? There was a period of time that bothered me. I probably should have gone elsewhere. Just one. Oh. And it may be one my entire life. How much money you have in the bank? What's the value? How does monetary worth factor into your self-worth? How about how many likes you get on your Facebook posts? How about position or power or popularity or authority? Does your ability to impact the world or have influence in the lives of others give you a sense of increased worth? Think about those things. Psalm number 8. There are three introductory observations that jump out of this. Let's check in. Most Bibles, I can't guarantee yours, but in most, I looked through about a dozen this week, different translations. They all had the same thing, but I know a few Bibles may be different. Most of the Psalms, underneath Psalm number 7, it's going to be one or two lines in italic, all right? And then the first verse starts. And those are important in that today as well as the rest of the verse. Psalm 8, for the director of music, Gilleth, a psalm of David. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. How many of you thought that was just words to a song we sang in church? Okay. You would be right. You raise your hand. It is, but here's where it comes from. It comes from this verse right here. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, a couple of different translations says, from infants and nursing babes. One translation says, from small children and sucklings. Okay? So you get the picture. You have ordained praise. What's the most vulnerable creature on the face of the earth? An infant baby. Okay? We have no natural instinct of what to do. Animals, they do. Humans don't. You leave a baby, it's done. It's toast. Okay. Because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger, when I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man or who is man that you think about him, that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him. The first man is talking about you and me. General, okay, humanity. The second phrase, the Son of Man, this is a reference, this is a messianic prophetic statement about Jesus Christ who is to come. Okay? You made him as well as us. Both first Adam, second Adam, all right? And if you don't know what I'm talking about, catch me on another sermon. We'll figure that one out, all right? But Jesus referred to as the second Adam, the first one born perfect. I mean, the first one created perfect, the second one born. Okay? But you made us lower than the heavenly beings. In other words, he made us lower than the angels in power. None of us in this room are as powerful as Michael and Gabriel, all right, the two archangels. They're more powerful, but they're not more loved. They're not more important. They will not sit as joint heirs with Jesus Christ for all of eternity. Just a small side note. Forgive me. We often take the sentimentality of songs and emotion, and sometimes it prompts us to put images in our head and to say things that really aren't accurate. My mother, who I love with all of my heart and is now in heaven, she's not my angel in heaven. She's my mother in heaven. Jesus Christ died for my mother not for Michael and Gabriel. Okay? To say that your loved one in heaven is going to be it's to move them down a step in God's position of love and authority. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? Angels are created beings. They're never born. They didn't mention. It was a once and done for the angels. Lucifer was an angel like Michael and Gabriel. Okay? Once and done. He rebelled against God. Okay? Literally. Hell. Okay? That's his place. It's his domain. When you and I die in heaven, we are God's children. We are his sons and daughters. We have received the redemptive price. Okay? Moving on. Anybody mad at me? Okay. And you crowned him with glory. Remember what God told Adam? Everything in this garden is yours. You're in charge. You take care of the animals. You take care of the crops. Are you? This is all you. Everything is under your feet. All the flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea and the swim, and those that swim past of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. There are three introductory observations before we finish the first verse. The first thing I want you to notice is a psalm written by David. It's written by David, as the scripture says, all scripture is given by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So this is not just the reflections of a very creative mind, but he has given this as a song, as a gift from God to all of humanity. The second thing I want you to note is the superscription that this is on the Gilith. The root of this Hebrew term has a little bit of debate in history, but most of the scholars believe this Gilith is derived from the community of Gath. Does that ring a bell with anybody? Gath? Where does it ring a bell? Yeah, be bold. Goliath, that's right. Goliath was from the city of Gath in the Philistine nation. All right? You're saying, well, why would David write about the city of Gath? Well, David had a little bit of something to do with Goliath, right? It fits, all right? So this was the hometown of the arch enemy of David. The giant that David stoned hailed from this community. And you can find that in 1 Samuel chapter 17. The term very possibly refers to a musical style that was associated with that culture or an instrument that they commonly used. Regardless, the expression on the Gilith, or according to the Gilith, appears above two other psalms in the hymn book of Psalms. You'll find it at Psalm 81 and Psalm 84. And the scripture tells us that after David's victory over Goliath, that the people of Israel sang and danced in the streets as they celebrated the triumph. One of my favorite all-time authors is Chuck Swindoll. He used to pastor down in Southern California in Fullerton at Evangelical Free Church there. He now pastors a church that he started out of Dallas, Texas, a little town called Plano. And Swindoll suggests in one of his writings, and I fully concur with him, that this psalm, Psalm number 8, was composed by David as a hymn of praise in honor to God who gave David that epic victory over Goliath and Gath. And as you and I peruse this psalm today, we'll see that it seems to fit that historical background. This is a song of celebration. So if you have a giant to slay today, if you showed up at church with a giant on your back, if you showed up with a giant of some sort pushing into your soul, in this case, maybe a personal giant of feeling insignificant, then take heart. This song is just for us. The third thing the introductory comments indicate to us is Psalm 8 begins and it ends with identical statements. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. And this repeated phrase offers three implications to us. First of all, the psalmist is speaking on behalf of the people of God, not just himself. David sometimes writes a psalm and he speaks about himself. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. Okay, very personal. And this one, he's talking on behalf of the community, us, our. It would be like me saying, okay, join with me. We're going to sing this together. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. But you see, before it can be collectively true, it must be personally true. If you're here this morning, you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, then when I would say sing with us to our Lord, you are welcome to sing, but you would not have the personal privilege of a relationship with our Lord. Get the picture? So David is talking on behalf of Israel, but there were Israelites who weren't living. So he's telling them, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. This is because it's God's victory for all his people. The victory that David had over Goliath was just not for David. In fact, David didn't even pick the fight. In fact, David wasn't even involved in the fight originally. He kind of butted in. Well, or for lack of a better term, nobody else would butt in, so David volunteered. Nobody, I'll fight him. And so he went out. But the victory that David had over Goliath was for the entire nation of Israel. The victory that Jesus Christ had on the cross 2,000 years ago over sin was not just for Tim, it was for all of us. But the only way it becomes available to all of us is when individually we accept it. Get the picture? The name that's spelled in the Hebrew, capital Y, capital H, capital W, capital H. We'll talk more about that in just a minute. It's identified with that which is majestic. It derives from a Hebrew word, Adar, meaning wide, great, high, noble, beyond belief. David pictures our Lord as one who is gloriously, magnificently, absolutely majestic. And the Lord's works and attributes are not limited to Israel or just the land of Canaan. They are universal in their scope. The Lord God is no national or tribal deity secluded from everybody else. He's the God of the entire world. Because most of this psalm falls between the same statement, we should realize the repeated statement is the central theme of the psalm. If anybody wants you to ask you a question, hey, what's Psalm 8 about? You can quote the first verse or the last line. Okay? That is the central theme of this passage. And everything else is outlined as between those two. In fact, as I was studying that psalm this week, I realized, and for those of us who've been in church maybe, let's say, 30 years or more, there's an order to Psalm 8 that I realized was the order of every service, of every worship service. It starts out with a doxology. Do you all know what a doxology is? If you don't, Google it, okay? Or take a hymnal if there's a hymnal in a pew, and if you turn to the table of contents in the back and look up doxology, it'll give you a page number, okay? And it goes, praise God from whom all blessings flow, okay? Many of us know it by heart because we sang it so often, all right, in our youth. And we opened with a doxology and ended by giving tribute to the Trinitarian God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That was a doxology. It's how we began many of our worship services. And then what took place after the doxology was worship. And worship was two parts. It was praise and it was message. And then we end with a benediction. Okay? And sometimes the benediction would be the same as the doxology. But there was always a benediction. Let's use that outline, kind of as an outline for our thoughts here, all right, over the next few minutes. So let's begin with the doxology. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The first word in this Hebrew text embodies the transcendent majesty and the glory of God. While most Bibles render that first word, O Lord, it is actually his Hebrew name represented by those four capital letters I gave you a minute ago. YHWH. Because this name was and still is to the Jews holy. They never speak, they never pronounce that word out loud. Never. Us Gentiles, Americans, okay, we have to put a couple of vowels in there so we can pronounce it. Okay? And so how you'll find it spelled in our world, you'll see it in songs that we sing, is YAHWEH, and we pronounce that Yahweh, okay? And we sing about that, Yahweh. Here's how you have to understand the Hebrews thought that word was so special. The scribes not only would not say it, when they wrote it, they washed their hands first, they picked up their instrument, they wrote with it. You got to remember, they didn't have flick of my bick, all right, in those days. It was tough, you know, utensils. But they would write those four letters in the Hebrew, and then they would discard that writing utensil, wash their hands again. That's how holy this word was to them. The second Lord, O Lord, our Lord, used a different word. And this is the one that Amy Grant made popular a couple of decades ago, all right, with her song Adonai. Okay, Adonai. It's a title of respect, of authority and sovereignty. And the Jews would pronounce this word out loud when reading Scripture and encounter the Lord's Hebrew name, YHWH. Then the word translated majestic is a superlative meaning that He is mightier than everyone else. And when you put those three things together, those three words together, David celebrates the supreme power of God over everything that exists. He declares from the beginning that God has no rival and He is subject to no power and He reigns supreme over it all. A few things to ponder after this introduction. What do you believe is the most powerful force in the universe? An exploding star? A black hole? God is more powerful. The Force from Star Wars. Just went to see that finally, about 10 days ago. It was good. It was good. You got to like Star Wars. Shelley hated it, but she's never seen one of them before, so she's a little behind. Well, yeah, you didn't enjoy it. Yeah, she nearly slept through it, but I loved it. I was on the edge of my seat. God is more powerful than a black hole or an exploding star. In fact, the combined energy of every star and every galaxy in the universe cannot rival the power of its creator. As we consider God's omnipotence, what effect does His power have on our feelings of being underappreciated or overlooked? Now, David, having acknowledged God in this short doxology, reflects on the greatness of his God, and in doing so, he now offers praise. Observe as King David takes his place before a congregation of believers, and he's prepared to lead them in worship, and he says, God, you have displayed your splendor above the heavens, above a setting moon and a rising sun. From the lips of children and nursing babes and honking geese, you have ordained praise because your enemies, you silence your foe and your avenger. If you only write one or two things down from a sermon, I'm going to give you one line that we write down from today. Here's the line to write down to remember. The difference between praise and petition is the absence of self. The difference between praise and petition is the absence of self. You want less, more lifestyle? Then your prayers ought to be more of praise to God than petition to God. Okay? David leaves himself out of the picture. He declares the majesty and the glory of God are displayed in the heavens, and the Lord's invested the physical universe with awesome splendor of His glory. Psalm 19:1, the heavens are telling the glory of God. Romans chapter 1, verse 20, for since the creation of the world, the invisible attributes of God, His eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made. The brilliant scientist, Sir Isaac Newton, Google him too, okay? I love Google. And I shouldn't love Sir Isaac Newton. He was the father of calculus. I bailed out my second week of calculus, all right? But he was a father. He's the guy who came up with the idea of what gravity was. If you Google him, you'll find out he's considered to be really the father of modern science. Okay? I mean, he's the guy that exploded everything. I wished many of the present-day scientists would go back to the roots of their father. Listen to what Sir Isaac Newton said. He said, I can take my telescope and I can look millions of miles into space. But when I lay it aside and I go into my room and I shut the door and I get down on my knees in earnest prayer, I see more of heaven and I'm closer to the Lord than if I were assisted by all the telescopes on earth. That's the father of science speaking. There is an obstetrician who testifies that even before he became a Christian, he could not ignore the power of God as he delivered and then held in his hand one tiny screaming infant after another. He shares that this ultimately led him to a search for answers in the Bible, and finally it brought him to salvation in Jesus Christ. In a very real sense, infants and nursing babies declare God's power and majesty. It brought that doctor to Christ. I remember the obstetrician that delivered Brant and Chad. local one in town. I wished I could tell you that I knew he was in heaven today, but to my knowledge, he never invited Christ in his life. He died last year. But I remember Dr. Ted taking the placenta. It's laying there on the table. And I remember him picking it up in his hands and put it in my face, and he turned it inside out and he said, "Tim, right here, God has given to us the cure for cancer. I don't know what it is yet, but it's here." He said, "Even in women who have cancer while pregnant, there's never any cancer cells in the placenta. Something in here." I wished he would have allowed that mystery to have prompted him to have gone further and found the answer to the cancer of his soul, and that would have been Jesus Christ. God's enemies are silenced even when the weakest, the infant and those who are nursing. There is, and forgive you, in my office, I have a picture of about every member of my family, but the one I prize the most in my office, those of you in the back won't be able to see this very well, and some of you were sitting next to Eleanor's parents right now, and I got permission. Some of you will remember little Miss Eleanor when she was born. We walked with Ricky and Cody Cox through their pregnancy and the birth of their baby girl, their first. They knew early on that she had trisomy 13. She was asked to abort. She says, "No. I'll carry this baby to whatever point is God's desire for my life." Cody and Ricky blessed Shelly and I with the privilege of being there. And God blessed them with approximately 21 hours of her life. 21 hours. This beautiful little baby girl still spoke to some about God. We might look at a tragedy and say, "Where is God in this?" Trust me, He speaks. He spoke to members of her family. He spoke to each of our lives. Never be the same because of God's kindness through this whole process. That's the kind of God who created the universe. Infants may be small and stellar spaces may be silent, but both convey a profound significance to those who are looking. So it's at those times in our lives when we may think we are no longer valuable or necessary. While God honors us by accomplishing His work through us, that is not the basis of our value to God. Hear that. What we allow God to do through our lives is not the reason that He loves us. He loves us whether we let Him do anything through our life or not. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. We are not valuable to God because of our usefulness. That's why I used to help clean up after all those weddings. He values us whether we are productive or not. There's an overwhelming comfort in that message. Human power and ability does not earn our Savior's love. He loves us regardless. A few things to ponder. If God loves you and values us regardless of our personal attributes, regardless of our strengths, our power, our wealth, our talent, our intelligence, or our morality, how does that affect our sense of self-worth? How does knowing that He loves us unconditionally every day, how will that impact the decisions that we make today? As David continues in this worship service, he opens up his mouth and he now shares a message from God, which is a significant theme of this composition. I can imagine him standing before the people and preaching about two things: the needs of humanity and the grace of God. Is there really anything else ever somebody should preach about? Every message ought to be connected to the needs of us and the grace of God who cares for us. First, he considers the pitiful inadequacy of humanity. Read verses 3 and 4 contemplatively this week. That means slowly. Think about them. Try to capture a mental picture of what David has in mind. "When I consider your heavens and the works of your fingers..." What do we do with our fingers? Don't be like somebody at my 8 o'clock service. I got a visual from the audience, somebody doing this, all right? Don't do that, okay? Now, what we eat, We hold our utensils, we eat with our fingers. We don't do a whole, we'd miss them if we didn't have them, but creation, the scripture says, was thrown into place by his fingers. The moon and the stars you've set in their place. What is man? Who is man to you when you can do all this stuff with your fingers? Consider is the word that means to behold, to see. What I saw this morning, the rising sun and the setting moon. David was out in the splendor of nature as he looked around, and he was gripped with the starting realization of God, you are awesome and great. David refers to God's creation as the work of his fingers. We can go to other verses, and I'm not taking the time to obey, but 3 in Isaiah and 1 in Psalms that talks about God, with your fingers you may have created the world, but with your arms you brought about salvation to humanity. In asking the question, what is man? David uses an uncommon term for man. He uses the word Enosh, E-N-O-S-H, and it comes from the root word. It means to be weak, sick, or frail. And comparing that to the splendor and majesty of God, it could be read like this: O Lord, what is puny, weak, frail humanity compared to you? And according to David, God overlooks our lowly circumstances, and he acts on our behalf in 2 ways. He takes thought of us, and he takes care of us. He takes thought of us means God remembers us. He never forgets you. At whatever stage of life you're in, God never ever forgets us. And God will take care of us. Peter tells us in 1 Peter 5:7, God cares for those who trust him. If you don't think God's taking care of you, maybe you better figure out if you trust him. Because the scripture says he takes care of those who trust him. And then this prompts David to reflect on the grace of God. Verses 5-8. Yet you have made him a little lower than God. You crown him with glory. You made him to rule over the works of your hands. In spite of the vast difference between God and man, David declares, the Lord has set his love upon us, and he's given humanity a place of dignity and importance in the world. Moreover, he gave us the responsibility and the privilege of ruling over this world as his vice regents. Historically, this idea is applicable to all of us as humans, that God has given us dominion over the world. While Jesus Christ is the Son of God, we share that honor and responsibility with him. Is that not amazing? A few thoughts to ponder. Take the time, sometime this week, if we have a clear night, to go out in your backyard and look up at the stars. As you study the vast stellar spaces, remember, God loves you more than the stars, individually more than he loves this universe. And then, examine your habits and your choices. Are your habits and your choices driven by a desire to earn love or just to receive the love of God? You and I must know we are front and center in the mind of God. Front and center. Remember, this is a psalm on the Gilith. David composed it as a victory hymn after defeating the giant Goliath. I challenge you, take the personal giant that you walked in with. Take the personal giant of the feeling, I'm overlooked and I'm underappreciated, and ask God to give you victory over it today. Who knows? Another Goliath might fall before the sun sets today. David concludes his song with the benediction, the same words he used in the doxology. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And what's the word at the end of a benediction? Could we all say, amen? Take a moment to recall a time when God has come to your rescue. Pause to thank him because he cares for you. Tell him how grateful you are for his attention to detail in every area of your life. While circumstance may place you on the sidelines, we remain front and center in the mind of God. Let me tell you how this has been working in my head this past week. You've been hearing me talk for a little over a year now that this will be my last decade. Don't know that I'll make it all the way to the end of the decade, okay? Shelly tells me I got about 5 years, okay? I say about 7, maybe 8. We'll see. God's got a time for that. But this is towards the setting sun, guys. And so what am I going to do after that? I don't have answers to that. I now have a grandson in Tennessee. Okay? Maybe a good possibility we would live somewhere closer there. No idea where Ashley will be at that time. Have no idea. And so here's the way this played out in my brain the last week or so. Satan said, Tim, you really going to leave Clovis? I mean, you walk down the street and everybody says hi and people die and they call and ask you to do their funeral and people want to get married. And this is the work of the evil one. He says, you probably should stay here where you get the pat on the back. You go there. Nobody's going to know you. You won't get those calls. And I had to sit for a while and think, whoa. What will be the emotion that will drive those kind of decisions in my life? What is it and why is it that Tim Roland, who was called by God to preach His truth, why is it that you keep declaring His truth? Why? For me or for him? Real big motivation wake up. And here's the way I hope my life ends. I hope my life ends the way Robert Reed lived his life. I have everything I need for joy. Those were the words of Robert Reed, whose hands are twisted and his feet are useless. Robert Reed cannot bathe himself, he cannot feed himself, he cannot brush his teeth, he cannot comb his hair, he cannot even put on his own underwear. Strips of Velcro hold his shirts together, his speech drags like a stretched audio cassette. You see, Robert has cerebral palsy. The disease keeps him from driving a car, riding a bike, going for a walk, but it did not keep him from graduating from high school, going to Abilene Christian University, from which he graduated with a degree in Latin. Having cerebral palsy did not keep him from teaching at a junior college and venturing overseas on 5 mission trips. This will only be 4 for me. And Robert's disease did not prevent him becoming a missionary to Portugal. He moved to Lisbon alone in 1972, and there he rented a hotel room and began studying Portuguese. He found a restaurant owner who would feed him after the rush hour and a tutor who would instruct him on the language. He stationed himself daily in a park where he distributed brochures about Jesus. Within 6 years, he had led 70 people to the Lord. One of them became his wife, and her name is Rosa. I heard Robert speak on a YouTube. I watched other men carry him and his wheelchair and put him on a platform. I watched them open the Bible and lay it on his lap. I watched his stiff fingers force across the pages, and I watched people in the audience wipe tears of admiration from their faces. Robert could have asked for sympathy or pity, but he did just the opposite. He held his bent hands in the air and he boasted, "I have everything I need for joy." His shirts are held together by Velcro. But his life is held together by joy. And I hope whether it's at 70 or 75 and 80 and 85, whatever, I hope life will be held together, not by good deeds and not by good works, but by the joy of the presence of the Lord Jesus in me. How about you? Our Father, the evil one wants us to feel underappreciated, wants us to feel bypassed. But you promise that you will never bypass us or forget us. May we rest in the victory of the cross and the tomb. And may we live every day in the vitality of your Son, the Lord Jesus. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Just before you go, next week, chapter 13. Following week, chapter 15. Thank you, very good. I'm just checking you out. Way to go. 13, 15, and 19. Some of you stayed awake. Good job. Next 3 weeks, 13, 15, 19.